Hello.
And welcome.
To Tuesday.
Tuesday.
Feels like a Monday.
The day after President's Day.
Which is a liberal holiday attempting to erase our founders.
Yeah, especially George Washington.
And Abraham Lincoln even, who we know is not safe. No one is safe.
No one is safe from the left.
Arguably, you know who also isn't safe? This is a great transition. William Shakespeare.
Uh-oh. I feel like William Shakespeare hasn't been safe for quite some time. But he's the kind of character that we see pop up into the Target sights of the left every once in a while, kind of as a recurring theme.
Well, right, being that he himself is very old, or would be very old if he were still with us.
Kind of ableist to go after William Shakespeare, if you ask me. Ageist, I guess.
A rotting corpse somewhere under whatever church that is. You're right. This is something that comes up every now and then, but is again making headlines again because this push to get rid of books that are deemed inappropriate or uncomfortable. Also, Shakespeare, the plays are just automatically uncomfortable. Like, that's kind of the point of tragedies, is not to be warm and fuzzy. But obviously, that's a fact that's lost on the modern left.
Yep.
And so we see Shakespeare now, again, on the chopping block, if you will, when it comes to curriculum for teachers to pull from, when it comes to what's available in school libraries. And they, again, are trying to erase arguably one of the older, like, representations of Western literature, even if it's quite barbaric of itself.
And we've seen this before, most recently, in Burbank, California. We saw the left's strike of book banning, book burning, proverbial book burning occurring with a number of titles, including Of Mice and Men, Huckleberry Finn, a handful of others. And we had a great initiative here at YAF where we actually, free of charge, sent out a package of all these banned books from the Burbank Unified School District.
Right.
And we sent them out to all these students who were being, you know, having this information being withheld from them by the school district because precisely that they thought it was too uncomfortable, too divisive, essentially anything that's not progressive enough for them, which is exactly where we see ourselves here with William Shakespeare.
Right. The people who are pushing for Shakespeare to be removed from polite society or education, whatever you may want to call it, are saying that it's all about colonialism and colonization, which is a common thing that they attack. And what's interesting is that they say that if you're going to read it, you must be required to address the whiteness of your thinking.
Not only that, but they also say that if it's going to be presented at all, it needs to be with watered-down versions of the original or supplemental texts focused entirely on equality issues, which really completely shines through any sort of veiled good intentions that leftists might have here, or at least try to present. Because in the very end, it always comes down to their equity dream. And if you can't read William Shakespeare through that lens, then he's got to go. He's got to go.
Well, yeah, and it's just interesting that, again, their focus, like, how do you read Shakespeare with a focus on equality? Like, kind of the whole of Shakespeare's work, in a way, is based in inequality, and that's, like, the inequality is where the tension in his work comes from. So, like, Romeo and Juliet, how are you supposed to read that without a focus on inequality when, like, that's kind of that sets up the main conflict in the play, but you can't have that inequality.
Well, I think one thing to be said about leftists' desire to rid the world of all inequality is that these violent delights have violent ends, which is said by William Shakespeare himself.
Wow.
In case, I have a list here of William Shakespeare quotes that I'm going to try and litter in here.
Can we pretend this is a who said it? And I'll just guess William Shakespeare on all of them and look really smart. My mom, who's an English major, will be very proud.
All that glitters is not gold, Spencer.
I'm pretty sure that's from Smash Mouth. Trek,
both and both and. Well, I'm sure the left is coming for Smash Mouth soon enough anyways.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, let's take a look here about, we're looking at a Washington Times article that did some good reporting on this, the headline being, "Woke teachers want Shakespeare cut from curriculum. Quote, this is about white supremacy." Apparently the issue that I think they're a group of teachers who are taking issue with this.
Teachers, to be clear.
Indoctrinators, as we call them. They take fault with his, quote, unwoke attitudes regarding race, sexuality, gender, and class. I hate to break it to the left, but most of Western civilization has not been focused on trying to rid the world of inequality regarding race, sexuality, gender, and class. So if that's the standard they're going to set, like...
Arguably, though, what's interesting is that Western civilization has, as an effect, although not its goal, rid the world of most of that.
Yeah. So especially, you know, the great inequality of the inordinate amount of disease, poverty, and war that has torn the world apart since the beginning of time.
As everyone throughout basically all of U.S. history has pointed out, we are the greatest force for good in the world. Mm-hmm. And the United States, again, is the land of opportunity. And there's a reason everybody wants to come here. And it's not because they want to be part of an evil, unequal society. They want to come here because of the opportunity. And you often quote some of our speakers who talk about, if you want equality, that means if you have absolute equality, then everyone is just dirt poor and unhappy. Mm-hmm. But if you have inequality, then you have the opportunity, then that means to rise out of whatever your current situation is.
And I think it was Milton Friedman who said that if you have a society geared around achieving equality, you won't attain it. But if you have a society that's geared around achieving freedom, you'll have a high degree of both freedom and equality. One of our favorites here at Young America's Foundation.
And I think sort of the scariest part of this ongoing, but again, recently resurfaced push to get rid of Shakespeare is one of the quotes from a gentleman, I believe, I don't want to assume because it's a California educator, but they say that the... Producer Kyle has better things to listen to apparently today.
There's a follow.
Oh, who followed?
Nepotism.
Nepotism subscribe.
Oh, we got a sub. Thank you, Nepotism. Shout out to one of our great freedom activists who's in the chat today. Thanks again for the subscription.
But apparently, since Shakespeare's work has been considered exemplary and universal, these claims must be discredited, which is half the battle of the left, is just telling us that we shouldn't do it. But then what's worse is the second part of the quote, that is, Shakespeare's removal from the curriculum and the collective memory is thus mandatory. So not only do we need to discredit the lines along which he wrote his stories, we have to pretend that that never happened.
I hate the word mandatory, especially when it's
profoundly an unfreedom.
Yeah, and especially when we're talking about some leftist cultural, you know, utopia. I mean, I've said this on our YAF Twitch streams before, but a lot of these things that we cover are really just a hop, skip, and a jump away from mandatory re-education camps.
Which is basically what they're saying, because, I mean, everyone our age and older read and learned Shakespeare. Like, I had an entire class in college that was just Shakespeare, and anybody who's taken Western literature or even just any form of literature or playwrights, anything, has read Shakespeare. They want to erase all of that. They want to memory hole that all for all of our own brains.
Yeah.
And it's mandatory. It's not a you ought. It's a you will forget that Shakespeare ever existed. It's not good.
This group that is pushing for this kind of rewriting of essentially all Western civilization,
all of it.
The group has declared themselves as openly wanting to remove staples of Western literature from school curriculums. I don't know who needs to hear this, but if your stated goal is to disrupt Western civilization, you are the bad guy. You are the bad guy.
Yes.
The problem is when people are so deep down the rabbit hole and they really are willing to say these things, not just in private, but out loud, sometimes on the internet, it's real hard to reason with some of these people.
Right. It's not a good starting point when the other side, when conservatives, or it's not even really a conservative versus liberal issue. It's just a sanity versus insanity issue. But if you believe that maybe we should learn from Shakespeare, which has been,
God forbid,
kind of the
bigot,
kind of the standard for a very long time, which again does not make it a bad thing. If your starting point is that up against somebody who believes you don't have the right to remember Shakespeare existed, it's hard to find a middle ground.
I for one am not going to listen to the people that think that men can become women and vice versa. I just think that's just a good jumping point to go off of.
I think, yeah, that's fair.
The lady doth protest too much, methinks.
Definitely Shakespeare.
Good job. 10 points.
Which this kind of rolls us into another thing we wanted to talk about today. This came to our attention on Twitter from Chris Rufo, who, if you don't follow him,
give him a follow.
He's very, very good on Twitter. And it is a scoop about how the principal of East Side Community School in New York sent white parents, apparently only, this so-called tool for action. We got another
follow from STK, wow, reading is hard.
Oh.
Maybe I need to go back and read some Shakespeare. STK Fusion 5, thanks, and welcome to the stream.
But this school in New York sent parents a tool for action which tells them that they must become, quote, white traitors, and then advocate for full, quote, and a subscription from STK Fusion 5.
Hey, welcome to the stream. Thanks for subscribing with Prime.
And then advocate for full white abolition. That is this document. So this... It looks friendly enough. It's a little speed dial something.
Yeah. The 8 white identities, it starts out.
Which is, I don't necessarily
the
understand.
Scale. The scale. It's
a wide range that we have here. And this is the quote that goes along with these that I'm about to read is, there is a regime of whiteness and there are action-oriented white identities.
Mm-hmm.
People who identify with whiteness are one of these. So you're one of
no
these.
No exceptions.
Whether you like it or not, you're one of these. It's about time we build an ethnography of whiteness, since white people have been the ones writing about and governing others.
Okay, I'm just going to point
out
that...
Why is others capitalized?
That's a great question. The ethnography of whiteness does not sound like a good thing at all. And coming from the progressives is even a little scarier.
I don't understand. So, your options that, again, you are one of these. Please pick the one that...
That these leftists demand that you fit in.
Is appropriate for you and show your work. So all the way on the goal is, again, to become a white abolitionist. So in the green zone, we have white abolitionist. Then we have white traitor. Then we have white critical. We have white confessional.
I should be pointed out, we're slowly going towards more acceptable to the left. Sorry, no, less acceptable to the left.
So white confessional is the last kind of before you go over the hump to the wrong side, where you have white benefit, which is something I've not actually heard before.
That's new to me,
then
too.
You get to white privilege, which we've all heard a million times.
Apparently, we've been told multiple times that anyone who's white, and particularly on the right, lives here.
Yes. Then white voyeurism, and then white supremacist, of course, on the far side of this. And what I don't understand is, why can we not just all agree that white supremacy is a bad thing? and then do away with the rest of specifically white abolitionists, which again, I'm not sure I understand if that means.
Well, I think, don't forget, this email was sent out specifically to white parents at this school. I mean, advocating, sending a specific note to all the white people saying, you guys need to be on board with abolishing your race. Am I understanding this correctly?
Actually not, and I'm glad you brought this up, because thankfully there's a helpful guide that was also included for parents that kind of explains what all of these buzzwords mean.
Oh, gee, thanks.
So again, white supremacist, which again, everyone can agree is bad and should not be, not be a thing. If you believe that, you are as racist as the left's people who believe that your skin color determines your idea's value in the marketplace. But white supremacist, which means clearly marked white society that preserves, names, and values white superiority. Bad. We can all agree on that. White voyeurism. Is someone who wouldn't challenge a white supremacist, desires non-whiteness because it's interesting, pleasurable, seeks to control the consumption and appropriation of non-whiteness, and a fascination with culture, for example, consuming black culture without the burden of blackness, which of course would be how you get cultural appropriation in that idea from the left. White privilege is someone who may critique white supremacy, but has a deep investment in questions of fairness or equality under the normalization of whiteness and the white rule. Their sworn goal is diversity. White benefit is somebody who is sympathetic to a set of issues, but only privately, and won't speak or act in solidarity publicly because benefiting through whiteness in public. Interestingly, it notes that some people of color are in this category as well. So you can be a person of color and still be taking advantage of white benefit, which is just one step away from white privilege and three short steps away from white supremacy. White confessional is someone who offers some exposure of whiteness, but as a way of being accountable to people of color afterwards, and they seek validation from people of color. White
kind of sounds like liberals.
Yeah, I think that's probably fair. White critical is somebody who takes on board critiques of whiteness and invests in exposing or marking the white regime. They refuse to be complicit with the regime, and it's whiteness speaking back to whiteness, which is a sentence I don't understand.
This is like the Ten Commandments of progressivism.
Then white traitor is somebody who actively refuses complicity, names what's going on. Their intention is to subvert white authority and tell the truth at whatever cost, and they are needed to dismantle institutions. And then white abolitionist is the person who is committed to changing institutions, dismantling whiteness, and not allowing whiteness to reassert itself.
That was a lot. That was a lot to unpack right there.
I'm just going to leave this here as a cheat sheet for you.
It's always important to, point out that the left's definitions are always so far off from what the actual reality it is of what they're talking about.
Yeah.
Like we said at the beginning of this list, the first one is their worst of the worst, white supremacists. We're both sitting here, obviously in agreement that white supremacy is terrible.
It denies the very conservative idea that every person is endowed with the same rights by their creator, and a government should respect, protect, and ensure that those rights are not infringed upon, which, oddly enough, some of these would infringe upon those rights. But
it's so hard to come to the table with the left when on condemning this sort of thing, when they're willing to label anyone who disagrees with them marginally as the worst of the worst in these categories.
Right.
So,
and what's interesting is they sent it only to white parents, but then there is that white confessional that some, or no, white benefit that some people of color are in that category. Which is interesting. And I think that would probably be, I think white benefit would be kind of how the left, that is how the left characterizes people like Alan West, Burgess Owens, claiming that they're sympathetic to whatever the left's messaging is on this, but only privately, and that's won't act in solidarity, meaning they won't come out and say, we should, for example,
dismantle whiteness.
Right. So I think that's where most leftists would say conservative people of color. Which is absurd and despicable that they would, all of their talk about
literally
all
a
white
racist
people are evil.
Sentiment.
It's all racist. And it's insane that they get away with it and they get propped up in the media because they get all these think pieces in Huffington Post. Is HuffPost still a thing? I literally have not been on that website in.
I hope not. If we're dismantling anything, HuffPo. Sorry.
Throwback to to the good old days when Spencer was a college student and he was on HuffPo Live.
Oh, yeah.
I was the conservative token they would have on just to use as a punching bag. I would just sit there and be like, yeah, okay, that's stupid. You want to hear why? I remember even back then when I was, this was like 2014 or 2013. 2013, I was on talking about a transgender MMA fighter. And why that was unfair. And they, I have never seen a group of people more aghast at me just stating that, like, a biological male competing against women is unfair in boxing. They did not seem to agree with this. And I was like...
Boxing. In, like, one of the most violent sports.
I didn't determine anyone's DNA, so yeah. It's not my fault that I'm pointing out the biology of this. But anyway, those were the good old days.
This thing that we're talking about, once again, from Chris Rufo on Twitter... this thing went pretty viral. I mean, this is a lot of shock value. This is the kind of thing that I think conservatives would do a good job of sharing and kind of exposing among sympathetic center-left circles, people who have their head on straight but still buy into some of the progressive agenda. I mean, this stuff is so crazy. I think a lot of people would see this and just be disturbed at how absurd this is, let alone the actual content. But the fact that this school district is sending this, singling out white parents to send this to, as if, oh, you darn white parents, you better get your heads on straight. A pretty racist concept in and of itself. So this is the stuff we've got to highlight. This is the stuff we've got to show people.
Can you look up the school?
Eastside Community School, yeah.
In New York. I kind of almost have a sneaking suspicion that this is either a private school or like a charter school. In which case... Their website is terrible.
It's in New York. They have a very bad website. They have a Twitter account. Oh,
they should worry more about their web design and less about shaming people. Is there like an about?
Looking for an about. There we go.
A boot. And yes, Llama Lover, Spencer was in college. Thank you, producer Kyle.
Yep, it's a public school.
Interesting. It would be fun to maybe submit a public records request.
Yeah, there might be this. Might be a civil rights case here.
I think we have some work to do on this. Anyway, but as we were talking about, you know, conservatives, black conservatives specifically, are often lumped in with the white supremacists by the left.
Yeah.
And somebody who has been and borne the brunt of that, a lot of our speakers, basically all of our speakers who are black, are routinely... take incoming slurs from their supposedly tolerant white leftists.
From the people who are saving them, citizens, from the evil racist conservatives.
Which is nuts. But whether it's Byron Donalds or Burgess Owens, who are both in Congress now, people like Mia Love, she takes a lot of that stuff. But also Lieutenant Colonel Alan West, one of our favorites.
Yeah.
Probably one of my all-time favorite speakers, whether it's on campuses.
This guy's hardcore.
Or at our conferences. My all-time favorite, I think it's probably on our YouTube channel and our Facebook page, but go on there, search his name. He's giving a campus lecture for us once, and a student gets up and asks him if he identifies as black. If you don't know who Lieutenant Colonel Alan West is, yes, he is. So this this super, you know, woke...
like jittery, like angry, like visibly upset.
Has just heard this very good, impassioned, factual... endorsement of conservative ideas and defense of our ideas from Lieutenant Colonel Alan West, and she has the nerve to get up and ask him if he identifies as black.
Do you identify as black?
And we should honestly have him on and or interview him somehow and just be like, what was the thought in your mind? Like, what did you think she was going to ask? Did you immediately comprehend and process what she had just asked you, and what did you actually want to say before you gave a very eloquent "Yes, I identify as black"?
I mean, does anything quite highlight the just delusional, anti-reality, progressive stance that these people have when someone gets up to ask a question?
She probably thought he identified
clearly
somewhere
to a black man,
somewhere on the wrong side.
I mean.
Somewhere on the wrong side of this graph.
Right. It should be noted that Alan West, and we do encourage you to go watch this video on our YouTube channel, Alan West handled this very calmly. He just kind of chuckled. He goes, yeah, I'm black. Like, it was a total like, mic drop moment.
And she's a mess. But I bring up Lieutenant Colonel West because we reached out to him today to get his reaction because he just has such good reactions to the news of the day, and you sometimes catch him on TV, but we hadn't seen him talking about this yet, and we wanted to get his take on it. So this story is up on the New Guard. This is another story that was broken by our own Kara Zupkus.
Link in the description.
The link is in the description. Producer Kyle tells me, so you can click right over to it. And this is a study from the very serious education experts at Harvard.
Top of the line school at Harvard.
Harvard. I'm credibly informed, the premier institution of higher learning in this country.
I believe.
I can't say with a straight face because it's just not true. Mm. But they came out with a study that is peer reviewed, mind you. This is not just like a white paper by some department. This is a...
What happened to the peers? They've been going downhill for a while now.
Who are these peers?
Peer reviews have gotten terrible.
Pull their heads out of their keisters. It's ridiculous. So this is a Harvard study, peer reviewed, that found that slavery reparations would have reduced COVID-19 cases. Just let that settle for a second. So this is a report by something called the Lancet Commission, which should not be trusted for anything, but it's the Lancet Commission on Reparations and Redistributive Justice.
I don't think there's such a thing as redistributive justice. I'm not sure that exists.
I think it's just doubled down injustice, potentially. I think that's kind of what that is.
We are going to redistribute the justice.
You can't. It's not how it works. But anyway, so this study claims that the disparity in COVID-19 cases between Black Americans and White Americans is due to, quote, structural racism. And again, their conclusion was that if only we had provided reparations for Black Americans, we would have decreased their COVID-19 risk. And their reasoning was as flawed as their conclusion. Yeah. But they cite a number of variables, including claiming that Black Americans would not be forced as frequently into high-risk frontline work.
Forced.
And that reparations would have increased their ability to access masks and hand sanitizer.
Yeah.
Two things that are available free of charge in most cities and within the, like...
Let's go to a restaurant.
Airports, train stations, everywhere. You can get them for free. So again, we reached out to the good Lieutenant Colonel Alan West to say, hey, what do you think about this study, knowing that he would... send us back a very strong paragraph, which he did. And he said, to shorten this, it's absurd. Fact check true from Lieutenant Colonel West. And he said, quote, I'm a Black American who has had 6 COVID-19 tests, all negative. I take my health care as a personal responsibility. Smart.
A novel idea.
And work hard to prevent myself from being afflicted with the major health issues that affect Black Americans, such as type 2 diabetes, obesity, high blood pressure, and heart disease. No amount of reparations is going to resolve this. He said, quote, what this report seeks to do is continue to perpetuate a slave mentality among Blacks. It is an endeavor to continue the economic enslavement and dependency society in the Black community. It is this clear and present soft bigotry of low expectations that has been the greatest cancer which has infected the Black community at the hands of delusional leftist elitists.
Wow. I mean, strong. That is very strong.
He hits the nail on the head, though. That is exactly it. How many times do we have to talk about this soft bigotry that often is not actually all that soft? I love that term, the soft bigotry of low expectations. But it's really not that soft at this point. Like, it went from being, like, you know, one of those, like, inflatable, like, hammers you win at an arcade to being just, like, a jackhammer.
Titanium baseball bat.
Yeah, it's not such soft bigotry anymore. But it's that same idea. But again, it's these delusional leftist elitists at a place like Harvard that are telling Black Americans that they apparently cannot possibly keep themselves safe, keep themselves healthy, provide for themselves what they need to keep their homes clean and keep their families safe. It's absurd.
And I think the root of this comes from the idea that these leftist elitists are so wrapped up in this progressive brainwashing of kind of the same thing that we see from the 1619 Project, that everything started, begins, is currently happening, and ends with the institution of slavery in America. Mm-hmm. Everything can only be seen through that lens. There's no possible way that these people who put together this study at Harvard could, they can't come up with any possible explanation for a disparity other than it has to be slavery. They can't think of any of the hundreds of thousands of reasons that different groups might end up in different places from one another.
Right.
And believe me, I mean, there are, it's almost impossible to even calculate them all because there's so many different complex reasons, whether they're economic, they're social, they're cultural, that go into creating these disparities between people. And leftists, what they do is they look at these disparities and they pinpoint zoom on the only one thing that really is no longer that big of a problem today in America because of the great ideas that this country was founded on and that we've worked to achieve better and better throughout time.
I just did a quick study. Can you peer review this? Can you review this, Pierre?
I'm the peer. Let me just review this real quick. Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
Okay, YEF is proud to announce a new peer-reviewed study. Leftists are weird and their ideas are bad. Make a trend. I don't know if you can read that. We're going to publish this. I don't think Harvard will carry this study, but it's peer-reviewed.
Mm-hmm. I'm peer.
More accurate than Harvard's.
Yeah.
I would like an honorary doctorate.
That actually might be more scientific than this Harvard study. You know, we might have done more research just now here with this peer-reviewed study than the great institution of Harvard, which really was founded on a strong tradition of the West and Judeo-Christian values. I can't remember exactly
It was basically a Bible college.
Mm-hmm.
And now
it was Christian-centered.
I mean, that's how all the Ivy League schools started. And if I had a time machine and could bring back the founders of the Ivy League schools and set them loose in a gender study class today,
that'd not be good. It's really sad how far these great institutions
Hashtag
have
leftists are weird. Make it trend, Llama Lover. Show me the heart. I think we should just start a new social media campaign.
Leftists are weird.
Hashtag all posts.
Leftists are nerds.
That's good. Perfect. Yeah, it's thank you, American me. Purple heart. I don't know. And this is, I mean, the left has so manipulated so-called racial justice or racial equality in a way that is how they have taken everything else, manipulated it, and used it just for their own power.
Yep.
Because their idea with this is, again, telling everybody who doesn't agree with them, they're just going to slap you with one of these eight labels, preferably the four that are bad, according to them, or the worst of the worst, and use it as a means to shut you up. That's what the whole idea of intersectionality is all about when it comes to how much privilege you have versus how much you're oppressed. The idea is to give the oppressed more right to speak, more value behind their ideas. But of course, the actual privilege or oppression you've experienced means little, and it's actually about whether you agree with their ideology. And this is the same thing, where they're just trying to come up with more ways to say, well, we can't allow X, Y, or Z to speak because we said so, but with supposedly academic backing, none of which is better than our study that we just did and peer-reviewed in front of you.
Yeah, and I want to point out basically what you're hitting on here on intersectionality and the dreamboat goal of equity among the left is they use these same ideas that are coming out of this peer-reviewed study from Harvard. I love doing this scare quotes because this is just so ridiculous. I can't give this any credibility.
Nope.
I think in the state of New York and potentially some other states, there were pushes to have vaccine distribution go to certain identity groups before those that we know are the most vulnerable and most in need of vaccines.
Follow the science.
Yeah, follow the science, people.
It's not that
difficult. I mean, people were interested in getting queer, transgender people of color the vaccine before, you know, Ma and Pa in the old folks' home.
Yes, which is crazy because, again, after...
Poor Meemaw.
Talking about New York, I mean, you have Governor Cuomo, who is now having his own party in the state of New York calling for an investigation. Yeah. So, like, he's got his Emmy. He has hung himself way out to dry over his skis, other metaphors that apply here. But it's just insane that while he is ignoring science in the first place, that has therefore killed, we literally don't know how many people, because it turns out he was lying about how many people had died after he ordered COVID patients housed in nursing homes with the most at-risk group that we know of. Now he was then not going to make it right by giving everybody who survived his first attempt to kill them the vaccine. He was going to make them wait for the preferred people, which is the thing that's buried and kind of lost in a lot of this is going back to what the conservative opposition was to the Affordable Care Act / Obamacare when that was introduced. And everybody called us crazy people for saying, like, there are going to be death panels. If you have the government deciding who gets care and who doesn't, you're going to have governments playing favorites, and the powerful or the well-connected or the rich are going to be the ones who have the best access and the best healthcare, and everybody else who's relying on the government is going to just have to hope that their number gets called based on some characteristic that's in vogue.
Yeah.
And everybody thought we were crazy, and they were like, this is fear-mongering, whatever. We literally are seeing this now with the rollout of a COVID vaccine, which arguably is not necessarily as much of a life and death situation as whether you're eligible for cancer treatment or whatever it may be.
Which have also been put on hold thanks to COVID.
Right. But it's a very real example of how when the government is in charge of allocating resources such as life-saving healthcare and a life-saving COVID vaccine, you can't trust them to actually do what's right by the citizens. they're going to do whatever they feel like gets them a woke star.
And your freedom and opportunity to be able to achieve those ends for yourself is stolen, taken away, and given to the elites who then make decisions on your behalf.
How many of the Harvard peer reviewers got their vaccine before, like,
Oh, that's a great question. That's we should do a peer-reviewed study on that.
I think we should just release an academic paper a day and just be like, peer-reviewed by Spencer and Kevin. Uh-huh. It's just, it's absurd. Mm-hmm. It's absurd. And that's, I mean, that example, this is why conservative ideas work, because you can apply it to any situation, see the flaw, and find the conservative solution for whatever that problem is. So whether it's a COVID vaccine allocation, or you look at what was going on in Chicago, if you've been following us, you've seen Governor Walker has been on a lot talking about what happened in Chicago with the teachers union between them and the mayor, Lori Lightfoot, and the students and their families just caught in the middle with no way out, basically, because the unions had so much power, that now you have Lori Lightfoot fear-mongering, sounding like very much like a conservative, saying that the Chicago Teachers Union would run the city if they could, which, in effect, that's what they've been doing for this whole thing.
Well, and unfortunately, thanks to progressive politics in that city for decades, there's no way out, because they don't have the kind of conservative reforms that Governor Walker put in 10 years ago, and they don't have the kind of muscle weight to push back against the unions and the freedom to kind of go around them. Chicago's stuck in this tunnel, and As great as it sounds to have Lori Lightfoot saying, like, look, we need to get these school opens.
She emboldened them as much as
you
anybody
guys,
else.
You guys dug this grave for yourself. If this isn't a wake-up call for a lot of progressives who live in these cities that have just been devastated by leftist policies for decades, if this isn't a wake-up call, then I think years down the road we're going to see the really devastating results of these policies, particularly as a result of pulling kids out of school for more than a year now.
Well, and the problem with the way the left is very much the elite party in group in the country is all of the people in Chicago who have the power to change this have had their kids in either private charter schools or Catholic schools since it started. So their kids have never had to
be at home. The Catholic schools in Chicago have been open for a while.
They've been fine. So the parents were able to do that. When it comes to crime and violence in Chicago, all the gun violence that goes on there, everybody...
How do they have gun violence?
Guns are banned, but there's a lot of people getting shot by something.
Ghost guns. Must be the ghost guns.
That's something else to worry about next time I fly through O'Hare. But the people who are in charge, they just hire private security. We saw that in Minneapolis, too. After Minneapolis voted to defund the city council there, voted to defund the police, and you've had carjackings through the roof, murders through the roof, sexual assaults, rapes, everything through the roof, the city council was afraid of what? I don't know.
A peaceful protest.
Hired private security and charged the taxpayers.
Yeah.
So they say, you, small business owner of a hardware store on the south side of Minneapolis, you're on your own. Good luck. But we are going to charge you and your closed business for our security so I can sleep well at night.
That policy is the result of years of Hollywood hypocrisy. I mean, how many stories have we heard of Michael Moore types, you know, the big leftists who just want to completely get rid of guns for people and then will be walking around with gated security guards and all sorts of protections that they have for themselves because, you know, security for me, but not for thee. I mean, and now we're seeing these things play out in real time. Yep. Another example, I mean, what was the thing a couple weeks ago? John Kerry flew on a private jet to go
because
collect some environmental
award. What was his
quote?
For him, it's like the only
option. Because for a person like me, it's really the only option.
It's the only way.
Holy cow. Is that not the most elitist statement you've ever heard in your life?
I now refuse to fly anything but private.
Where's Greta Thunberg calling out John Kerry?
First of all, she
needs to get in a boat and sail across the ocean and protest.
Seriously, if I was Greta Thunberg, I would be very upset because I was made to sail around the world while John Kerry is
on a private jet. I have a message for John Kerry.
How dare you? Can you at least, like, yes, Greta Thunberg, to repeat Michael Knowles' now infamous line, this is a mentally ill girl who's being used by the left in order to push this stuff. At least she was committed to her delusion.
I mean, and at least she was committed to boat across the ocean.
Like, credit.
John Kerry's like, I don't even care about any of this. I'm just getting paid.
John Kerry arguably would have been safer on a boat than on a plane.
Yeah.
But no.
Especially with the Iran nuclear deal. I'm sure there's some missiles flying around towards them or something like that.
Yeah, probably. But no, so this is just like the continual problem when you have power of any kind concentrated with a small group of people who are unaccountable to the people who put them there, who they supposedly represent or are supposed to protect or wherever it may be. And it's why, like Governor Walker highlighted with Act 10, the whole idea is taking power from the hands of the unaccountable and putting it back in the hands of just everyday people and whoever they have actually duly elected, and not whether it be union bosses or these unelected bureaucrats in state health departments deciding who gets vaccines. It should just all be the people and who they elect. And that would be a good thing to return to. That
sounds great, doesn't it?
It sounds great, but guess what? It's not happening in many, many, many places. And it's why, I mean, like, if we could get an Act 10 in all 50 states, as the governor's pointed out, this is not something that you can just take to D.C. and fix it with. You need this kind of policy at every state level, because the state houses and the state departments and the local city, municipal, school boards, whatever, is where you actually fix this stuff.
And, might I say, much easier to actually make a change.
Yeah, because instead of trying to convince a majority of the American people, you're trying to convince a majority of your neighbors, who hopefully, well, I guess not this
and
year.
We all know how well Congress works together, so.
Not well. Gonna cut that one off there. Yeah, it's just why, and again, conservative solutions work, liberal ideas and supposed claimed solutions do not work. I don't know if you saw recently, I think it was Virginia or maybe Virginia Beach. It was either the city of Virginia Beach or just the whole Commonwealth of Virginia rolled out their website for getting vaccinated against COVID.
I haven't seen this.
And in a beautiful ode to the Obamacare website initially, it immediately crashed.
Oh, great.
And it's like, ah, yes, the government does know
best. Thanks, net neutrality.
They can't even make a website work where people literally are, it, they basically couldn't make a Google form work. It's like where the government competence scale is. Like, I could have set up a form for people to go in and put in their information and then email them back whenever it's time for their COVID appointment or their COVID vaccine appointment, excuse me.
I'm just imagining Ralph Northam running around the Virginia State Capitol just trying to put out fires in their server room. Planned Parenthood's on the phone. Like, it's just raining. He's like,
not
one
now.
One minute.
I've got to, hold on. No, I'll take your guns tomorrow.
Just
I need to
keep
get
the child
website
comfortable and let me deal with this.
It is truly absurd. And that, yeah. I feel like we could keep going on this rant for like a couple hours. While we're on this topic, if you can't trust somebody to protect people who are already alive against something like COVID, how can you ever expect them to respect life in the womb?
Yeah.
And the answer is, you can't.
Yeah.
But using the left's argument, which I think is probably how they're able to make the arguments in places like New York, that certain groups should get it before people who are actually scientifically at risk, is this just core, I would say maybe it used to be fringe, but it's today just a core belief on the left, and even maybe in major the party with which it's aligned, is just this idea that not all life is equally valuable.
Yeah.
Because clearly they believe that, whether it's the
certainly
unborn,
they don't believe all rights are equally valuable.
No, definitely not. But even just the core, like, that would be a great question just start asking people in press conferences.
Yeah.
Do you believe every American, not even every American, but just do you believe that every person around the world's life is equally valuable? They might say yes, but everything that they do on the left proves otherwise, whether it be funding abortion around the world with U.S. taxpayer dollars, whether it be treating people as more worthy of saving from COVID, whether or not they're actually more susceptible to getting COVID and then having adverse serious effects.
Yeah.
Like, it's just they clearly don't believe that. And because the left standards are always changing, inevitably those on the left who think today they're in a good place because they're valued, their life is currently valued by the left.
Just wait till those systems of power change.
Right, exactly. And so if you don't believe that every life has the same inherent incredible value, you're automatically going to end up on the receiving end of that, being on the low end of the totem pole, and therefore not surviving potentially.
And that's why I think a lot of people often point out to this woke leftism, the intersectional, you know, cultural Marxist view of the left is kind of this perverted woke religion, because they take ideas that have existed for centuries among the Judeo-Christian American tradition, like something that, like you were just talking about, the idea that all people are made in the image and likeness of God, and these progressives that are pushing this identity politics and these equity politics and racial justice past the point of equality, it spits in the face of those ideas in for
completely
their own new woke religion.
Right.
So, you know, we kind of laugh about the absurdity of, you know, whether it's the eight white identities or whether it's banning Shakespeare or whether it's this Harvard study that thinks that, you know, racial justice would have, you know, ended coronavirus. But we're dealing with some crazy ideas here. And so it really is up to the next generation of conservatives. We hope that any of you young people that are watching us can go over to our website and sign up for our individual membership. It's completely free. Join us in this fight. We're committed to fighting for the American tradition, for free enterprise, for individual freedom, for strong national defense, for traditional American values. And we totally want you guys to join up with us. So go ahead and search YAF membership in the Google internet machine. Join for free. Yeah, that's right. Buckley Bot over on our Twitch channel has been popping the logo in, or the link in there. So go ahead and click on that. We hope you guys will join us.
And if you believe in the apparently radical idea that all life is valuable and equally triggered.
Terrifying.
It's a scary thought, but a beautiful one. You should definitely get involved.
Sure.
And we provide you with the resources and everything you need in order to stand up for that idea in the increasingly hostile classrooms,
yep,
lecture halls, campus quads, wherever you may be, Zoom calls, since that's where most people's classes are these days. We will help you. And to celebrate this fact...
Looks like Mr. Producer has redeemed a DAB reward point. So we're going to close out with this. Thanks, everyone, for joining us, and we will see you next time. Thank you.